The Sheptytsky Institute is certainly close and dear to my heart, and one day we hope that there will be a satellite campus in Edmonton. We'll keep working towards that. I'm delighted to speak with you today. Is this about what the Ukrainian Catholic Church was like on the eve of the Second Vatican Council? And my presentation is part and parcel of what Professor Yaroslav Skira had referred to yesterday, those that were in his session, on the Metropolitan Maxim Hermeneutic Diaries from 1962 to 1965, a little bit earlier and a little bit later. We're hoping is this there will be a companion volume, and I've participated, and so this is where the paper comes from. I'm doing this from the lens of Metropolitan Maxim Hermeneutic, being born in 1962, so it's only in my seminary formation and beyond is this that I learned about the Second Vatican Council. But when we were in Ottawa and the Ukrainian Catholic bishops would come and visit with seminarians, usually with the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops, something in that regard, Metropolitan Maxim was the living memory for me as this of the Second Vatican Council. So much so is this when I began my scriptural studies, when they referred to hermeneutical studies, I thought that had something to do with Metropolitan Maxim hermeneutical. Obviously, it did not. My presentation is divided into two parts, thank you, and the first part is that I'm just going to rather skim over. My responsibilities were to paint a picture, both numerically and geographically, is this of the Ukrainian Catholic Church throughout the entire world. I don't think that is terribly of great interest to us here. Rather, I'd like to speak is this about what were some of the issues that the Ukrainian Catholic Church in what we would call the free world at that time, what were they dealing with? I think that is maybe of greater interest to you. But I do want to just mention the numbers. The Ukrainian Catholic Church in that time has found itself in North America, South America, just starting in Australia, in Western Europe, in Poland, Germany, France, Great Britain, and certainly it has moved on beyond that time. But it's interesting is this that with World War II and the Soviet communist regime is obviously when the Ukrainian Catholic Church in Ukraine is persecuted and goes underground, that they aren't able to report on their statistics. So the last statistics that we have are from the Annuario Pontificio, 1943. So in Ukraine at that time, and so these are the numbers that continue to be reported in the Annuario up until the Second Vatican Council and beyond. There were some 3.6 million faithful, 1.3 million in the Archeparchy of Lviv, 1.1 million in the Eparchy of Poremishuk, and 1 million on the dime in the Eparchy of Stanislav. It's interesting is this that despite the persecution, the numbers today would be 4.3 million worldwide, with by far the majority of those being within Ukraine. So the before and the after, I think, is a rather interesting project. But let's look at what were the first and foremost on the minds of the Ukrainian Catholic bishops as they headed into the Second Vatican Council. What pastoral concerns dominated the agenda of the Ukrainian Catholic Church in the early 1960s? And I do so as this by fast-forwarding to the end of the Second Vatican Council. On November 30th, 1965, the Ukrainian Catholic bishops that were present at the closure of the fourth session of the Second Vatican Council issued a common pastoral message. And the message includes amongst the significance of what the Second Vatican Council was going to mean for the Catholic Church worldwide, but the pastoral message also included three particular ecclesiological shifts that the Ukrainian Catholic Church designated at that time. And I'd like to say that these three ecclesiological shifts are still very much in play today. So I hope this is that our conference over these couple of days is not simply a looking back 50 years ago, but it's a journey that began at the Council earlier and continues into our days. Is how do we continue to carry on the banner of the work that needs to be done? Well, the first area that they identified was collegiality. And that's the common action of the bishops worldwide in the proclamation of the gospel to all nations. And before the council, episcopal authority had come to be seen as a delegation of papal power rather than something proper to each bishop as successors of the apostles. The pastoral message, secondly, identified the recognition of the mission of the Eastern Catholic churches in, if we can use today's lingo, in the work of evangelization. Through their unique theology, liturgy, spirituality, and canonical discipline. And thirdly, ecumenism and the work of furthering Christian unity as well as interreligious dialogue. I'd like to take a closer look at these three items. Regarding collegiality under Metropolitan Maxim Hermeniuk's leadership, the bishops began to meet much more frequently. First, the hierarchy in Canada, and then with their counterparts in the United States, and eventually all throughout the so-called free world, which obviously at that time excluded Ukraine. At first, it must be admitted that their fraternal gatherings modeled that of Latin episcopal conferences. However, in time, and especially with the release from captivity of Patriarch Joseph Slipay, the bishops have returned to a genuine collegial or synodal style of governance, more proper to the Eastern churches, as was called for by the Second Vatican Council. Within the council, however, the Eastern churches were recognized as, for the first time, as equal partners with the Latin church in the work of evangelization. And so Metropolitan Hermeniuk and others, as this very much spoke, forcefully in this regard, because this is the thinking was then, and perhaps there's still a remnant of that, is that the Eastern Catholic churches are called to evangelize solely within their ethnic lines, according to their own nationalities, which is farthest from the truth. And then thirdly is this the restoration of unity and fostering of Metropolitan Maxim and the Ukrainian Catholic bishops were concerned in particular about dialogue between Orthodox and Catholic, and more so is this with the Ukrainian Orthodox Church and the Ukrainian Catholic Church. Well, let's look at the Ukrainian Catholic Church and return to synodality. Metropolitan Andrey Sheptytsky is already in 1911, when he was speaking, is this to then the Ruthenian or the Ukrainian Catholic bishops, on the Ruthenian issue to the Roman Catholic bishops in Canada on his first pastoral visit. He spoke of two diverging ecclesiologies, East and West, and this is his quote. The Christian of the West, inclined by nature and by tradition to individualism, is personally attached to the apostolic see. The attachment to his bishop is part of his faith in the Holy See. The Christian of the East, no less attached to the constitution of the church, is so in another way. It is his priest and bishop whom he considers in the first place. And it is in their attachment to the apostolic see that he is also attached to it. Clearly, this was the Catholicity of the 9th century. It was by their bishop that they were attached to the church, not by the person of the Pope. So what we're going to see is this line of thinking emerging within the episcopal gatherings under Metropolitan Andrey Sheptytsky, in particular 1927 and 1929. So the first conference convoked by Metropolitan Andrey, these were two international gatherings, and they attempted, rather interesting, not to bring together just the Ukrainian Catholic bishops, but the Greek Catholic bishops, united by their Slavic heritage. So the first conference took place in 1927 in Lviv, And the focus of the meeting was to plan for future such gatherings. First in 2 years, and then it was hoped every 5 years thereafter. The topics that they wanted to discuss were going to be according to four commissions that they were establishing: liturgy, canon law, pastoral action, and church structure and organization. Well, the second conference did take place in Rome in 1929 on the 50th anniversary of the priesthood of Pope Pius XI. Among the matters that were treated were liturgy, discipline, ecumenism, married and celibate candidates for the priesthood, and church finances. In a desire to provide for greater unity among themselves in ritual liturgical practice, the bishops established an inter-eparchial commission to revise all liturgical books. Well, perhaps in part, with Metropolitan Sheptytsky's deteriorating health, lack of consensus on the question of ritual purification, in reality, the bishops couldn't agree on any kind of liturgical action, as is in they handed the project over to the Apostolic See of Rome. Well, this is with the Metropolitan Turing health, lack of consensus, and the political conditions in Europe, further conferences were not held. Fast forward past World War II then. In Canada, interestingly enough, the first bishop, Blessed Makita Budka, is alone from 1912 until 1951, so he has this huge territory to provide pastoral oversight for. But already between 1948 and 1951, Canada is divided into four exarchates, and so now you have more than bishops. It's a little difficult to hold even a conference together, Episcopal conference, when you only have one bishop. So already, this is prior to the Second Vatican Council, we're going to see the number of bishops growing first in Canada and then beyond. So in 1951, Archbishop Ladika, Basil Ladika, was the metropolitan, but he had an auxiliary in the person of Bishop Remenyuk. Ladika's health was poor. They had already scheduled a conference of the Ukrainian Catholic bishops in Canada, and so Metropolitan Maxim is the one that chairs this particular conference. And so the bishops put forth a rather ambitious agenda for future collaboration. The convocation of an inter-exarchial, they were exarchs or until 1956, an inter-exarchial synod, the erection of an inter-exarchial seminary, joint pastoral letters on the priesthood as well as religious life, the unified Ukrainian Catholic Press in Canada, joint publications such as a Ukrainian translation of the scriptures, catechism for children, and history of the Ukrainian Catholic Church, to name but a few. In 1954, this becomes expanded to include the Metropolitan and the bishops in the United States. And they met in Washington on October 25th of 1954, and Hermenuk had already prepared for discussion for them a draft on Lenten and what we would refer to as restricted times, as these were not rather uniform amongst the bishops or the exarchates themselves. And the bishops also discussed the possibility of collaborating on the promulgation of common law for the Ukrainian Catholic Church canon law or discipline in North America. Well, from that begins to expand from Canada to include the bishops of the United States to include the bishops of the free world. And so over a period of from 1957 to 1962, several conferences are going to be held. Indeed, they met five times over that period. Once in Toronto, 1957, in Philadelphia, 1958, in Rome, in 1959, in Munich, in 1960, and then in Winnipeg, in 1962. If we can back up a couple of years, already in 1960, and then this in 63, when Patriarch Joseph Slipay enters the scene, winning his freedom from Soviet captivity, things are going to change rather quickly. But first in 1960, Metropolitan Maxim drafted what he called statutes of the Ukrainian Catholic Conference, not synod, but conference, very much still based on the Latin model. And is this there, some of the aims and purposes that they foresaw fourfold: to keep all the Ukrainian Catholic bishops in the world in close contact for the purpose of maintaining and preserving unity of action in all matters of pastoral duties. Second, to study, decide upon, encourage, maintain, and coordinate all the ecclesiastical, religious, national, and social activities to help preserve, strengthen, and extend the Ukrainian Catholic Church. Third, to preserve the purity of the Ukrainian rite, read here liturgical rite. And fourth, to provide an organized protection of the rights of the Ukrainian Catholic Church and for its successful growth and development. It was approved by then Archbishop, the Pro-Secretary of the Sacred Congregation for the Eastern Church in 1962 for a period of probation. Until such time, there was already hope that the changes would take place in Ukraine. So they were going to do this temporarily. But they had one change at the conference. The conference's decisions are rather directives or councils, having no force of law, not being those of a synod. But we see is this in 1963 with Patriarch Josef Slipe, the first archiepiscopal synod. No longer are we calling them a conference, we're calling them a synod, albeit it did not meet with the approval of Rome, the apostolic see of Rome. And it will continue over the years until what we have. One of the unfinished business that we have is this with the Eastern Code, which is on the eve of the 25th anniversary, is promulgated in 1990, so next year already in October will be 25 years, is the extension of the jurisdiction of the patriarch or the patriarchal system outside of the original territories. And so those, including in the Middle East, may find that perhaps even a vast majority of their faithful now find themselves outside of the original territory. And so we're challenged by the Second Vatican Council and the Eastern Code and to move beyond that. Let's look at evangelization, the second area, briefly. Evangelization in unity and in right. And so we see this is that the Second Vatican Council is now recognizing the right of the Eastern Catholic Churches to preach the gospel to all peoples. Albeit this is still a growing phenomenon and something in great need for us to continue. Well, Metropolitan Hermeneuk saw that the Ukrainian Catholic Church could be stronger in their efforts in evangelization if they were a greater united in right. And the right is this, today we would speak in terms of theology, spirituality, liturgy, and canonical discipline. And so he begins work towards an Eastern Code, the thought already of the Second Vatican Council, an Eastern Code would be, but Metropolitan Hermeneuk is working towards a provincial synod, the first provincial synod of Winnipeg in 1962. And we can recall here that the metropolitan province in Canada is the first one to be established outside of Ukraine. Philadelphia will follow. So Metropolitan Maxim, together with the bishops, albeit in Canada, will convoke a provincial synod in 1962 in Winnipeg. And he's constantly in contact with the Eastern congregation because they're launching this provincial synod and they're going to look at matters of liturgy, of unity within parishes, fasting periods, feast days, iconography, and discipline amongst the clergy and religious, the role of the laity, etc. They're wondering, we're doing this, they had planned it several years in advance, and the Second Vatican Council gets called, and their lead says, no, you can bring this experience of synodality, of collegiality within the Ukrainian Catholic Church in Canada to Rome, and will gain from this particular experience. Well, the long and the short of is that the Second Vatican Council had reorganized and restructured so many things that this provincial synod, with the norms were never promulgated. And because they were going to be interparochial, we could speak at that time, it needed the approbation of recognitio, if we can use a canonical term, of the Apostolic See of Rome. So it's unfortunate in that sense, but it's an incredible picture, is this, of what the Ukrainian Catholic Church in Canada looked like at that time. One last point briefly is this, if I still can, yeah, is on fostering Christian unity. And Professor Yaroslav Skir spoke about this, so if I might just add a couple of points here. Already at the Council, this pastoral letter, this one is at the beginning of the Council, 1962, a common pastoral letter of the Ukrainian Catholic bishops present at the Second Vatican Council. And they write, "It would be a great joy if among all those numerous observers, other non-Catholics, we met observers from our Ukrainian Orthodox churches. Such presence of representatives of Orthodox bishops, which beforehand would not oblige them to anything, but nevertheless appears an expression of goodwill towards some sort of mutual rapprochement. We would have a chance to meet with them at the Council, share our thoughts concerning important matters of ecclesial unity, foremost with our Ukrainian nation, towards securing the eternal salvation of souls. We are convinced that our Orthodox brothers and sisters here in the immigration and back in the native Ukraine would be happy to hear of such a meeting, since all of them probably long for a return to ecclesial unity." So Metropolitan Maxim's titles afforded to him at the Second Vatican Council is that of father of collegiality, synodality in some sense, and is this his desire in his work. He meets privately with the Pope to seek invitations for Metropolitan Larion, for example, and Skripnik is this in the United States, and unfortunately this, those don't happen. However, what might be of interest and a topic for another opportunity is that the Ukrainian Catholic bishops drafted, although I've never seen it published, and it's still in mimeograph form, as appears in the minutes, a directory of ecumenical principles in the Ukrainian Catholic Church, based on the Second Vatican Decree on Ecumenism and the Decree on the Easter Churches. And it's one of the things that it speaks about is the sharing of sacraments, or communicatio in sacris, together as common prayer, liturgy and sacraments, especially with Eastern Orthodox Christians. So those three areas, I think, were issues that were on the minds of the Ukrainian Catholic Church as they were entering into the Second Vatican Council, and much more work needs to be done in this area. I'm pleased to report that the Ukrainian Catholic and Ukrainian Orthodox bishops of North America have now met some five times. We don't call them synods, we don't call them conferences, we don't call them dialogues. They're simply fraternal gatherings so that we can get to know each other a little bit better. We were to meet, we had dates set for, this was 3 years ago in Kelowna. It fell through when the Eastern Catholic bishops in the United States participated in what we call an ad limina visit every 5 years or longer now in Rome. And then it's just so hard to coordinate calendars. We thought we had our meeting set for Winnipeg this year with the Metropolitans Yuri and Lawrence in Winnipeg to host in August. But again, as this calendar comes into play, as I said, and so we weren't able to do that. So, 50 years ago, but the work continues today. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Vladeko. We have time for questions. We do want to leave a little bit of time before noon so that you can have enough time to get over to the lunchroom. But please feel free.
Thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you for the talk. It's very interesting. I appreciate it. I have two questions. Is the draft of the ecumenical principles for the Ukrainian Catholic Ordinance, has it been published? If not, you mentioned that it's not. Where would it be available, and is it still current, so to speak? Would it still apply today? And my second question is, would it be possible for our bishops to do the ad limina visits as a synod instead of regional visits from each country in little groups? Thank you.
Okay. And so I'm not aware of this. I haven't seen those ecumenical principles that were drafted by the Ukrainian Catholic bishops worldwide in Second Vatican Council. I haven't seen them in print. I can certainly scan them and send them off to you if you just give me your email address then too. Maybe that might be something interesting to add, is if part of the proceedings are going to take place in Logos. I see Professor Yaroslav. Do you know, have you seen those published?
They are in fact published. Hermeneutic diaries have a section in there where he describes the bishops talking about the directory of ecumenical practices. But then he laments that what he had constructed was in part rejected by the bishops and was limited to only some kind of simple lavins, common prayers. But I did find what I thought was a draft of what he presented, and it is published as an appendix to the diaries, but we're unsure of its status, whether it was the document he presented or whether it was the one that was accepted by the bishops. But it does read very much in the spirit of the Second Vatican Council.
I'll check my research at home as well and see if that was what appears in the diaries. I'd forgotten that it appeared as an appendix. The second question is this. I think that that's possible, and we've discussed that, at least within the context of the Ukrainian Catholic Church, as undertaking our limina as a church worldwide. And indeed, as this some of us accompanied when the Ukrainian Catholic bishops of Ukraine had gone, so some outsiders outside of the Ukrainian territory. But I think this would speak volumes to the if we might say the universality of this in the Ukrainian Catholic Church worldwide.
Question there behind Sister Anne. Go ahead.
I'd like to raise a question regarding the patriarch. There was a big grassroots movement to make Joseph CK a patriarch, and that wasn't an agreement. That was an issue of contention in the actual within the bishops' council. So I'd like to know what transpired there, and what the resolution, the progress, and resolution of that issue was.
Yes. So, Metropolitan Maxim from you would have assumed, with the support of the other bishops in the free world, so going into the Second Vatican Council, he would assume the chairmanship, the conference guidelines that I'd written, saw him as such, and the seat became that of Winnipeg. But already, this is with the appearance of Patriarch Joseph's Stipay, so Metropolitan Maxim hands over the reins, understandably, to do so. But there was division, dissension, is this amongst the bishops themselves, on a wide variety of issues, including that of the patriarchal status. I think this is Patriarch Joseph, as this was very, very much hopeful that the Second Vatican Council, as this, the Father's presence, would have recognized and afforded the Roman Catholic Church that title. I would say today, because I don't want to just leave it in 50 years ago, I'd say this, I don't know of any of our Ukrainian Catholic bishops that, at least within the celebration of the liturgy, that don't reference the current head of our church as a patriarch. And I appreciate this, since that officially this Vatican recognizes our church as a major archiepiscopal church, and we'll continue on that journey day by day.
Sister Anne, and Sister Stewart.
In regard to evangelization, I have heard that there are restrictions of our church evangelizing in areas where our people do not live. for example, Africa. Now, I'm not sure how many Ukrainians or Ukrainian Catholics live there, but that was a fruitful land because of Africans are used to married clergy, so the Orthodox churches thrive there. Is that restriction still imposed on our church?
I wouldn't say that it's a restriction. I would say is that there's still a lingering perception in some circles in this regard. Without giving too many details, I had a chance encounter with a Vatican official. We were at an installation of an archbishop, and there was just, you know, the usual pre-dinner or whatever people do before banquets. And he was just chatting with individuals, I was chatting with individuals, and both our groups left, and we literally backed into each other's politely, did not one over the other. And so I reintroduced myself, and he said, well, yes, I know who you are. And the first question that he asked me, he says, so tell me, what kind of problems do you have with your married priests in your eparchy? So I thought, well, I don't, but I'm experiencing a couple of problems or issues with a couple of my celibate priests, which I'd like to hear about that. So we proceeded for about half an hour to chit-chat in this particular area. And I said, well, I really think that the Second Vatican Council has reordered this. And there's still a remnant, there's still a small problem area in the Eastern Code that it's still a lingering after effect of that. But he ended, and I think that this is the point that I'd like to make with you, is he says, well, Bishop, you realize that you're in Canada, this was in a Canadian context, you realize this is that you're in Latin territory. Mm-hmm. Is this that you're the territories of the Eastern churches, which are Middle East and beyond, are rather restricted and limited. And I said, you know, I don't think that this would be the general thinking after the Second Vatican Council. So I said that I beg to differ. So we do have, I don't know the numbers, I haven't seen, but is this, there's some 200,000, I believe, people leaving Ukraine each and every year. So it's been a million since the early 1990s, 5 million or whatever it is. And some are in Northern Africa. So you're not far off. And I think is that each of the Eastern Catholic Churches, not just the Ukrainian Catholic Church, has the right and corresponding obligation to evangelize wherever we may find ourselves. The context of North America, Canada, the United States, which is probably most of us here, is we have reverted de facto to missionary territory. There's enough work for all of us to evangelize from our own context.
Professor Sierra and Father Hassan.
Bishop Duke, thank you very much for your talk. I was listening very eagerly to that historical period between 1960 and 1965 and the development of the statutes for the synod of bishops. In your studies, and you've done a bit of book on this and the research, did you have a sense where the Ukrainian bishops were developing a larger self-awareness of them being a synod of bishops during this historical period? And I ask this because in the diaries, the way Metiuk writes, is at the beginning of the council is simply a gathering of bishops or conference. But by the time you get to the end of the diaries, they have a very strong sense of, Metiuk has a very strong sense of this being a synod that has a patriarch at its in leadership. But so the question is kind of very historically limited. Do you have kind of any insights on that period?
Yeah. So I had the fortune of being the fifth bishop in the Eparchy of Edmonton. And so during all of this period, from 1951 or thereabouts, all the way as this into the Second Vatican Council, the bishop was the secretary of all of these conferences, and then initially for the initial synods was Bishop Neil Severin. He took copious notes. And then is this the official protocol of the minutes were published, but we still have his handwritten notes. And if you talk about an environmentalist, he had these tiny, tiny pencils. He wrote in the margins everything. And he could take pretty well everything verbatim. So in with that in mind, we do see this growing sense. They saw themselves as conferences. And maybe this is with the leadership of Metropolitan Maxim Hermeneu, who was really a statesman, but he really wanted to work with Rome. And he wasn't going to be one that was going to be in your face. This was all going to be very diplomatic behind the scenes. He certainly is trying to advance synodality even within the Ukrainian Catholic Church. But it's really not until, in my mind, until Patriarch Joseph Sleepy arrives on the scene. And already at one of their very first meetings, they changed the constitution, at least in draft form, that the decisions will not simply be niceties, but they will be legally enforced within the Ukrainian Catholic Church. That's still a challenge even today for us inside Ukraine and outside Ukraine. It would be the same situation for the other Eastern Catholic churches.
Father Miroslav?
I'd like to mention that the background of my question really relates to the pre-Vatican II period. When we read about what was happening with our church in the Vatican II period, we kind of focus, I think, on the issue of patriarchy and the base and perhaps confusion or conflict among the bishops. So I wonder whether it would be helpful if you could at least speak to a bit. Metropolitan Henry makes an interesting comment in his diary, which I'm really grateful to have published, at the first meeting of our bishops. And it was a sense of relief, I think, saying, well, this wasn't as bad as last time. He makes a comment about the debates weren't as, I don't know the exact wording, but basically my impression was it wasn't as bad as the last meetings. So clearly there were conflictual issues before. I don't know.
Sorry, so not the Second Vatican Council sessions, but meetings of the Ukrainian Catholic bishops.
The first meeting of our bishops during the Vatican Council. So he's alluding to earlier meetings. So I'm just wondering whether it would be helpful for us to realize that, and it's not a matter of digging up dirt, but realizing that there were hot debates going on before, and it wasn't all just about or upon the arrival of this debate.
Yes, so it has to be said that there were certain, I may phrase them as personality issues amongst the Metropolitans, for example, the United States, Philadelphia, and Canada, and then Pope Francis talks about this warning the bishops and the Monsignors is not to climb the ladder. Well, there were issues of who should have been the Metropolitan, who should not have been. So those were lingering personality issues. And those colored the issues that they would have discussed at the time. And perhaps some of that is linked to how Eastern do we want to be in the face of the Apostolic See of Rome. And again, it's that statesmanship of Metropolitan Maxim. I didn't see him doing it any other way.
There was a question at the back there behind Father Lee. You, yes?
In my studies of theology in Rome, Reverend Duclair, who's at the Furia de King of Nature, underlined an important thing that I hear very rarely. You were speaking earlier about Metropolitan Sheptytsky. This was the same giant who in 1914 called the Zeist a meeting in Belgrade on the topic of ecumenism. So he anticipated Vatican II for many years. How come we don't hear more about that as much as we
I only have 30 minutes. perhaps, I'm not sure, is this yesterday or today? I know is that there are other sessions or talks or speakers that have been addressing ecumenism. And I don't know if they have an opportunity. But there are some wonderful articles and e-books that address more completely the foresight of Metropolitan Sheptytsky in regards to ecumenical matters. Certainly a spiritual giant and a man ahead of his times, ahead of the Second Vatican Council.
And next question, regarding the Triple Maxim Hermeneu, isn't it correct that during the Second Vatican Council, he's the one that proposed that the anathema of the Eastern Churches versus the West and vice versa should be withdrawn? Is that not his original suggestion in Vatican II?
That I'm not not sure. I don't remember. Is there anything in the diaries in that regard? Did you catch anything?
This is the same time that Yves Congar is also writing on a similar topic, but Manuk does mention it. He brings up the topic informally in letters, and I'm not sure if it was in a formal intervention at the council, but it is brought up in some of the correspondence between him and the Curia in Rome.
Nice segue. Is this in the diaries, Metropolitan Maxim is rather pleased when he promotes conciliarity, synodality, as he said. Even Congar has thought very highly of this Metropolitan Maxim's interventions.
And the last quick thing, is it not true that when Khrushchev had asked President John F. Kennedy for a favor, President Kennedy asked the Pope John the 23rd, who asked the bishops of Vatican II, and it's Metropolitan Maxim had when you said, we want Major Diosdek released from the Soviet concentration camp.
And don't forget the intervention of President Kennedy in this regard. And a fine thing that Metropolitan Maxim did.
I thought there was one final question. Father, relax.
Since Vatican II, the Latin Church has started to have synods again. We're having one now. We had one on the Middle East. From my experience, it tends to be a very different type of animal from the synods traditionally in the Eastern churches. Has the reintroduction of synods in the Latin Church helped you or not helped you in getting your point across about synodality?
So you're referring to the people's synods?
Yes.
That every several years, and we have this extraordinary one taking place then too. I think this is that maybe the seeds of synodality that Metropolitan Maxim and Patriarch Joseph and Patriarch Maximus and others, as this we're presenting at the Second Vatican Council, when we meet with our Roman Catholic brothers in the episcopacy, say at the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops or the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops, they're much more familiar with synodality. So I think that the progression from in our church, the Ukrainian Catholic Church, from conferences to synodality is heightening the awareness universally.
It was Joseph Ratzinger who said that national conferences have no theological standing.
Well, I would say, and I just hope that I'm not just overly optimistic and hopeful, that the Episcopal conferences that were foreseen at the Second Vatican Council will in time emerge or morph into something more synodal. Maybe not completely, but it's say the issue of the election of bishops. The principle of subsidiarity, the Second Vatican Council, both Eastern codes speak highly of this, what can be done at the local level. Right now, it's the bishops will make a list regionally, the Roman Catholics, and then it disappears. It gets presented to the Apostolic Nuncio. Is that changed, amended, names are added, deleted? They have no idea. So I think they're following with great interest how bishops are selected in the East. Always problematic within the territory and outside of the territory. But at least it's a move forward. I think that synodality will be something that the universal church, the Roman, the Latin church, will continue to pay greater attention to.
Thank you, Bishop David, for your...